hope you've all had a chance to see the exhibition on the floor below this one of Hitomi Hosono's ceramic work. This is Hitomi here. I think it is a rather remarkable exhibition. And we're very grateful also to Adrian Sassoon for working with us to bring that exhibition here to the Daiwa Foundation. The main event is Hitomi this evening. And just to briefly introduce her, I mean, her work speaks for itself, but she studied ceramics in Kanazawa and then in Copenhagen and got an MA here in London at the Royal College of Art. Already her work is collected by a number of major institutions, including the British Museum, which is represented here by Nicole Manier. Who I think it's probably fair to say is the leading expert on Japanese ceramics in this country. And Nicole is also the founding director of the Sainsbury Institute in Norwich, the Sainsbury Institute for the Study of Japanese Arts and Cultures. But she's been for some time seconded from there to the British Museum, which is where she is mainly to be found, I think, these days. I'm still slightly unclear about how they're going to do this. It's going to be a dialogue, but I think in the early stages of the dialogue, it's going to be more Hitomi talking, and then there are going to be more questions later, and of course there'll be an opportunity for all of you to ask questions a bit later on than that. So over to you.
So, well, I thought that what we would do is we would start by just asking Hitomi to tell us a little bit about where she is now, and then we go backwards and then look at where she's come from and then the processes, and then come back to where she is now and where she's going, and then we ask a few more deep questions about porcelain's possibilities, and then we open up to the floor. But I just wanted to say, and I don't know how many of you have been to the Mitsubishi Corporation Japanese Galleries at the British Museum, but they've completely changed for me since Hitomi's work has been in place. When you go into the galleries, when you come right in, right at the front, her work is right there. It's in really the first case that you see. On the left side, you have this fantastic Kofun period, so 5th, 6th century, well, maybe late 4th century, but 5th century Haniwa figure. And then you have her spectacular flower leaf vase with 1,000 leaves carefully put in. And I've watched people come into the galleries and they all come not to the Haniwa figure. They come to her leaf vase. And actually, I think that is brilliant, because what we're doing is, the Japanese gallery's title is From the Past to the Present, but what I like to think of it as the present going back to the past. So it's, we live in the present, our eyes are in the present, but we gain succor and nurture from the past. And when I first saw Hitomi's work, and if we have time at the end, I'm going to tell you how we actually acquired it, but I won't tell you unless we have time at the end, so we'll have to just see, because Jason is very tight taskmaster, and he told us we have strict orders on when to finish. So you have to be a bit careful, this piece, when I first saw it, I thought this is a specific resonance with an ancient pot, which we will go into in a little bit. But and we have to ask Hitomi if that's really the case. But for me, in my imagination, I saw an ancient Japanese pot, and I thought this is perfect. So I'm really delighted to be here today with this incredible creative artist who is going to tell us about her works. And what I'm really excited about is, after we finish, going down in front of the pieces, and maybe we can get her to speak to the works themselves, which is really great. And what I hope you will all do is, at the very end of this, you know, tomorrow or at the weekend, go to the Mitsubishi Corporation Japanese Galleries and look at this wonderful piece if you haven't seen it, because it is spectacular. And the little blurb that you just saw for 30 seconds is going to be a film. This has been done by the British Museum team, this incredible team. We have some of the team members, and I've seen Gabriel has come in, and I'm delighted, has done incredible filming of Hitomi, and Patricia Wheatley has overseen this brilliant film, and so this film will be released, thanks to JTI, at the end of this month, and so you'll have it, it'll you know, be a 10 to 12 minute film. So we get a little bit more about Hitomi's process through that. Mm-hmm. But without further ado, I'd like to turn to Hitomi and ask her to tell us a little bit about herself, mm-hmm. the present, and then the past. Mm-hmm.
So, first, thank you. Very nice introduction, Jason. And thank you so much for coming today during the busy weekday. It's really honored to have so many people here. And first, I would like to introduce myself a little bit for someone who are not familiar with me. And, I am from Japan originally, and now nearly 10 years. 9 years I living in the UK and first finished Royal College of Art to study ceramics. And then afterwards I working as a ceramic artist with Adrian Sassoon and at the studio in Kingsbury Park. So, and this, I must say this piece in the British Museum, it was just such a big thing for me. And this is myself working in the studio and it was a huge piece and actually technically also quite difficult and even like six people need to carry sometimes. But when I saw my piece now installed in the British Museum in its beautiful Japan gallery, I find that actually this is, it's not just I made it here, but actually collection of memory from my time in Gifu, Japan. And because this rustling leaves somehow remind me again that this rice farm that my family run, they create a really nice sound, the rustling leaf sound. And kind of I can hear the sound from this piece when I visit the museum.
Can I just break in and what attracted to me is this piece and in the British Museum we don't move it, to be honest, it stays. And when we do have to move it just a wee bit, it takes four people.
Okay, not surprised.
but we don't move it. And so that's one of the beauties of it staying there. But one thing that I think is really important in Japanese art and when you think of what Japanese art is, we've worked a lot on that, is the concept of art in Japan traditionally is very performative, and it's about feeling and about sensing. And it's just what you said, when you see this, you sense the leaves rustling.
That's been, but I also like two thing elements in the nature I wanted to express. So these rustling leaves have a really sensitive fine detail. So when we look at the tree or any plant, it has always two beauties, like a really mighty power coming up from the earth and really strong the trunk, but also leaves really fine when you look at it, really sensitive, and I wanted to make something really combined. And that's actually since the time I'm making ceramics in Japan was my interest. Yeah. And then when I looked at this piece, actually it's very surreal because I am the person now living made this, and I mean, no picture here, but this Jomon pot, it's made in thousands of years ago, like, 3,000 BC, so 5,000 years ago, but somehow, really, uncanny, it looks similar, like, what we like, what kind of this shape we like, it's actually never changed, so, for me, it's, that is really inspiration. So after I made this piece, still getting inspiration from this space. So this is a close-up. So I try to capture this leaf which naturally moving and also rising up from the ground. So I apply from the bottom to the top, and the bottom was really far away with my short arm, so I had to use a chopstick to try it for me many times. That's what I did, but I really wanted to do it. And then this is sometimes in the nature, things grow secretly. like the, when you water plants and you don't see something happening, but then suddenly next day you realize, oh, actually under the leaves, in between the leaves, there's a small bud coming out. And then these kind of surprise, you know, I wanted to express. So I also feel the inside full of leaves. And this is my farm, rice, not mine, but my family's rice farm in Japan. Now it looks stopping, but in the summer, in the hot summer at night, it all creates a nice rustling sound at night. So I used to walk with my mom to get a little bit nice fresh air. And I walked between, we walked between the rice paths. So, yes, I mean, this is from the time I was really little, I loved to help farming with my family members. So that it's kind of family time, the weekend in autumn. We all have to come out and harvest and hang the straw on this, you see the this stand. And then I used to play with a flower, small insect crawling around. but for me, that the interaction with the clay and earth, or this straw or rice is really, I think it was a good stimulation.
Mm. And this is your niece?
This is my niece, and yes, she also enjoyed just being around with family. So even though they don't ask her to come to help, she wants to come and help. It's really good. So this is
the same niece?
Yes, the old family members love Nico. And rarely they see someone from outside of Japan. So, and also Nicole from famous British Museum, which is in a textbook, you know. And then, so she you visited three times.
Three times.
And still, each time I go back to Japan, they talk about Nicola.
Her niece brought a ceramic she made, and I think that she's following after Hitomi's.
Yes, after you met her, she started more making things passionately. Yeah, with Craig.
She's the her mother right here. Can you tell us a little bit about your mother? When I first met her, mother is amazing. And when I first met her mother, she was formidable, a little bit frightening. And she told me, she said, "Do you think my daughter can really make it as an artist?"
Until the moment she knew that my piece in the British Museum, she used to say, "Oh, you have to get proper job. Because you can't get by just making ceramic, so I don't know. But there is a reason, because the Gifu, the place where we live in Gifu, it's like Stoke-on-Trent in Japan. So the ceramics everywhere, they produce tiles and tablewares and high-tech ceramics and everything. And many people engage in ceramic business, so for them it's really kind of normal and mundane. So when my mother think the career, that means something else. Do something else. But now she changed her mind. I'm really happy I'm making ceramics, because now it's an amazing museum of my piece.
Museums.
Yeah,
many museums. But you can see the kind of the wonderful humor, but also the steel in her mother is very much in the daughter. Mm-hmm. And I think that's what comes through in the mm-hmm. pieces. They're fanciful and lovely, but they're incredibly solid and strong. Mm-hmm.
So this is, she's in front of the straw flower and this vegetable garden. Behind there is our house. And this is Nadeshiko, and this is inspiration actually from my mom's plants in the garden. So that some of the pieces, even though I'm living here, I go back in my mind to live in Japan and get pull out. But sometimes just by touching clay, this memory comes out, and naturally I make it.
With this one, this goes back to your mother's garden. Did you actually look at photographs, or did it just, it was just in your mind?
The thing is, I didn't. I usually don't start from photography, photos, and I just think about it, and then just imagining, oh, how was life? They start making something with clay, and then you just, it's almost like a sketching on the paper. Try different shape. Yes, this is actually good. It was like this, kind of searching by touching.
So would you search the clay first, or would you sketch first?
Sometimes I sketch, but sometimes just start from clay. But the either depends on the situation and depends on the feeling. Mm-hmm. I switch, and then what I commissioned, I have to sketch first. But often, the things I draw on the paper wouldn't be in the last piece. The thing changed because the clay, porcelain especially, I think, have this amazing quality that can suggest maker what direction maker can go.
So the clay talks to you and tells you
interaction
what it really most, things that it can do.
Mm. So it sounds really how it's very difficult to explain, but it's not as simple as A to B. Sometimes you have to touching it, think about it, go back to material again, or try it, even like finish all and think about again, oh, it's wrong, go back again, start clay. So go back and forth.
I just remember one thing you told me that was so surprising. I hadn't heard it before, although maybe other people have said this, but you said clay has memory, and it remembers how you have handled it.
Yeah, almost for me, the clay is one person. They have their own mind, and unless we really understand what they want, what do they like, what they don't like, we can't really make really nice things. So that, for example, crack.
Yeah.
We have to understand what's the limitation.
So with cracks, yeah, or fissures in the ceramics.
It's a conversation that even there is a limitation, if you can go slightly different way, they accept my plan. So you have to kind of find, is it all right? The crack, no. Do you like this? Maybe it's okay. And then I can go that way. So it's really, really like listening and asking, and sometimes slightly changing. But because there is, for example, shape I wanted to make, but I can't force directly. Little by little, somehow, wiggling. That is finally the destination.
For example, if there was a crack in this, when it dries, it's over, right?
Because the crack, we can't really do anything once it's cracked. So we have to really experiment a lot. This one is chrysanthemum that my mom loved, and she always have in the in front of a Buddhist altar, in front of me. Then I made this chrysanthemum here. And this is actually quite decent work. And usually I made make a symmetrical shape, but I was looking at this terribly treated pine tree in our garden, but actually I like the freely they growing. The old branches go different directions, and the trunk is so twisted, and it really was inspiring. So I made this a little bit dancing.
It feels a little rootless, though. It feels like it has no roots.
No, we can walk, maybe.
Maybe this is a tree that started in Tajini, but that went over to Copenhagen and then it's come to, come to London.
I think that the usually the way we draw trees straight and branch out the leaves, but that's not only the beauty in nature. Sometimes it could be like twisted, and life is like that. And I wanted to do almost like a bonsai. So this is a piece, a moving shape.
You're moving trees.
Yes, and a quirky kind of twisted trunk and branches, a little bit leaf on the top.
Could you just mention a little bit about the gold inside?
The gold, yes, I think I spoke a little bit before, but it is quite influenced from our Buddhist altar at home. So the our Buddhist, usually the altar is like a cabinet, open, and inside is gold. And there is a heaven, there is a Buddha and Kanon, and it's just heaven. So this, I really liked when my grandmother opened it, the gold disappears. And then my mother used to say, there is a heaven beyond this gold. And then this feeling, I loved it. So I thought, why not I do that with my kids?
You have Amida's pure land.
Each time I look into the gold inside the bowl, it reminds me of my grandmother, grandfather. Yeah, heavens. They passed away and then went. So this is the river close to our home in Gifu, and it's quite steep, and the river have a weed under the stream. And then I quite like this, and I made one piece for it. But this is a bit different. This is the zenmai, which my mom and me used to go into the forest and harvest.
I think that's fiddlehead ferns. I think it's fiddlehead ferns, yeah.
So they are quite like this curled up tight in the center.
Yeah.
It's really powerful.
Does everyone know where Gifu is in Japan? Can you just explain a little bit about?
Yeah, Gifu is in the middle of the Japanese island, Hokkaido, and Okinawa is in the middle south. And then in the middle, relatively close to the Toyota City, where the big car manufacturer,
Nagoya.
Yes, Nagoya. But then this Gifu is in the Mino region, which has been producing Mino ware, the ceramics. So there are a lot of, I think now the 50% of tableware produced in Japan from this Mino region, and the 70% of tiles produced in Japan are from this place, Mino. So it is a really a ceramic this place. And
electric toilets.
Yes, but it's going really high tech nowadays, and they have amazing technology to produce this tiles which can resist like 15,000 degree heat in the outer space. So they made for NASA this tiles for the space shuttle. Or like my nephew now working for Nihon Gaishi in Mino, that produce this parts for electronics, which can, insulation.
Porcelain.
Yes. But and they produce also ceramics never break. But they stop producing because the school complained that the children never learn that ceramic. But that's a joke.
If you don't break them, you don't get new ones, your market dries up.
But that's the kind of industrial side. But they also have this Seto Oribe Sino, which is Arakawa Toyozo is a famous potter that from the Azuchi Momoyama era. They are making also these nice tables or more art pieces.
So you have art pieces and then you have mass products.
Mm, so the bowls, they coexist in one place, and it's really an inspiration for importance.
And what's so lovely, and probably you know this more than I do, but it, certainly in the Edo period, when you had big ceramic industries, the most important thing you needed was one thing, and that wasn't the porcelain, or that wasn't the stone, that was wood. Mm. You had to have wood to fire the kilns. If you didn't have wood and sustainable wood, you couldn't have an industry. Mm. And there is
lots of wood. Yeah, the Gifu Prefecture is not facing any sea coast. They have just mountains. So there are lots of pine trees. Akamas are very nice pine trees to fire a kiln. So it's no surprise.
And
so this is kind of about my family. So this is I didn't know why there is a raccoon in front of my house when I was a child, and why my house is covered by tiles everywhere. And I realized that my grandfather was plastering and tiling
specialist.
Yeah, specialist. So he was trained since he was very small.
Yeah.
To how to apply this tile. Uh-huh. And the amazing thing is, when I looked at it, I saw the industry somehow applied, but actually he did by hand, using this thread and pins. So he just throw the concrete on the wall after he plastered nicely, yeah. Small one, and then they put a pin somehow, the needle, they lining up each tiles.
Wow.
And there's no gap, some of the tiles, there's no gap even. But meticulously he did it. And so this house is kind of like covered by his work. So not only entrance, but next one you can see like this whole.
Oh, yes.
Yeah, this he didn't need to, but he's obsessed to cover. He obsessed to cover the whole walls with tiles.
Everywhere.
Everywhere. Even like he made our bathtub is really primitive. It's like the wood, fine wood from the
Goemonboro
square version. Yeah. All the bathroom is covered with tile, ceiling, floor, and everything, even bathtub. this is one piece remained, the one corner remained, because we had to take away. It was too old. But he did this one, it's like the one small one, this. And he ran the mat from left to right, exactly straight, no mistake. And then he's amazing.
If you look at the floor, and then there, and then
yeah,
here, and then.
But he also the arrangement really artistic, like these ones. Also, he didn't just put gray. Tiles. He also trying to make some interesting patterns, but which is a little bit unexpected things to discover, because my grandfather is absolutely short-tempered and very grumpy. I don't know whether it's true or not. All family survived because of his skill. That's what my grandmother said. That he was taken to Siberia in Russia in the wartime, and he had to work on the railway to in extremely cold environment, and he had to eat belt and shoes even to survive. But then the minister or someone could, the officer found he had a skill to apply the tiles so nicely, he invited him to the house to make a fireplace, and he got a job basically. And then he got the money and could buy the ticket to for the ship to go back to Japan. Yeah, so that's what my grandmother believed, that he saved.
So he told me he can be here today.
That's why the grandmother and my father, he was very small, couldn't come back to Japan. That's what
I think also, in this incredible attention to detail and to pattern, we get a hint of what Hitomi is.
the covering the whole surface with something.
Yes.
This is something I took over from my grandfather.
We're learning a lot already.
Then I moved to the Kanato, Japan, which is another ceramic place. Which is quite famous for this kutani ware that cover the whole surface with painting like this, and this is really something I like because I like to cover whole surface with something. So, but first I had to learn this technique. It's not as simple as just drawing or painting the brush. But it's different when on the paper, so easy. But because the glaze surface is so smooth, really we have to train ourselves to make a fine line. We really need a long training.
It's completely true, because I did some painting in Arita, and then I did a little bit in Kutani, and it's different. Arita is easy, because the red, it's different. You actually have to, you can't brush it, you actually place it.
Place it, yes.
It's just, there's more frit, it's incredible.
So I trained myself years, but I didn't want to just make, already people made, they make all the Kutani, traditional Kutani ware. I wanted to make some shape and patterns really make a good harmony.
So this is traditional Kutani wares.
I would say it's a traditional, and this one also the five colors, famous
yes.
for five Kutani
wares.
Yoshidaya,
Mitai,
yes.
But this is?
This is
this is Hitomi. You wouldn't know this, would you, looking downstairs?
But there is actually a similarity. The thing is, it's covered. And the pine tree piece, the things are moving on the surface, moving together with the shape of the body. So this is another interest I have since I was a child, that to draw manga, the comic.
We'll come back to that at the
end. I kept this a little bit secret because I thought becoming a comic, a manga artist is something I'm sure my mom would but this is secretly, I'm really enjoying it.
Do you know, I know a lot of you can speak Japanese and read Japanese, but do you see something here, those that you can? Do you see something that's going on here? It's a mongoro, it's tuna. but it's written in, you know, opposite. So she's reversed the writing on it.
Yeah, I quite like this a little bit of twist on a manga drawing. So when people reading it, somehow suddenly the whole letters mirror. Still they have to continue reading.
And then what's happening to this gentleman right here?
I really didn't just want to follow the conventional style of manga, which is left and right boxes. I wanted like one image that you can read in the drawing. So this is one episode happening that this the businessman trapped in the sushi, and he was drunk, he didn't realize actually he's now eaten by somebody from the outer space, but still he's not realizing it. So there's some of the people enjoying swimming in the yes.
It's fantastic.
So the idea, somehow I was into the bike so much to draw only, I draw this ending of Harley Davidson a few days without sleep. But these things actually, I was influenced on some of the manga artists like Umezu Kazuo. Mm. He drew the back of the computer without sleeping the 5 days. But absolutely, he was my hero.
Is this Hitomi?
This is in imagination. I'm riding on the bike. I'm not so brave enough to try. Like Harley Davidson, just I get on my friend's one, and that's it. So this is also trying to combine my manga drawing and kutani technique. So I use the 5 colors from kutani, but drawing something more funny.
And I think you all can see this, but this is a abalone shell. This is a shell. I mean, it's a ceramic, but it's a porcelain, but it's in a shell, and which is a traditional kutani shape for these foods. And what's so interesting about kutani ceramics, particularly from the 18th, 19th century, is that they were used with food. So you'd have food on them, and then you would eat the food, and then the patterns would come out. Mm. And I see a theme of food coming here.
So the being in Kanazawa is absolutely amazing experience, because the food, food is so delicious. So I got a job as a dishwasher in the nice Japanese restaurant near Saigawa, because we could eat every day. But they are famous for the seafood. I recommend everybody because food is for fresh fish and crabs, and so good. So my interest to the food in Canada also transferred to the ceramic work. So I couldn't help to make food with ceramic porcelain. So this is a natto, but this is a somen, the white noodle, and this is a namako, and this is a
mozuku.
Mozuku is appetizer, usually come.
Is that from Okinawa, like seaweed?
Yes, but they enjoy also the big mozuku as appetizer before the dinner course.
But if you can see, I think you can see this here, but if you can look really carefully, and I've seen the real thing, it's amazing. Do you see inside? Everything is completely decorated, and then there's a flash, a bit of gold all around the edge.
I don't know why this obsession really coming, but I really like something really dense. And it feels like almost something happening from inside. And it's a surprise. So this is the shrimp. Actually, now looks like a lobster. But this is a small shrimp that I enjoy in this Japanese restaurant. I want to make this shrimp and paint it with gold and eggs inside.
And the eggs. And the eggs coming out here.
Yes. And it's like a food for celebration. So I wrote a lot of celebratory words. And
are these fingers?
This is a fingers, and a very surrealistic the hand holding eggs. And this actually opens, so that when people open the egg, it is.
How big is it?
This is.
So about this big? Mm-hmm.
The gold eggs inside.
What does the base look like?
The base?
Yeah. Did you decorate
actually,
the bottom?
Actually, all over drawn.
Yeah, it's fantastic.
So I should have brought that image, but so it's totally covered with my paintings and writing. So this is also celebratory food, seedling, Thai.
It's in the Edo period, particularly from the later 18th century, you get a lot of blue and white arita dishes that are in this shape, to serve food. But not quite like this.
So again, to call more good luck, I wrote a lot of nice words, happiness or something.
But there's also other things going on here too.
Sometimes the people...
It's like a foot, isn't it?
This is a feet. Actually, the person combined with seabreeze.
Wow.
This is creature in between.
You probably all know this, but ceramics, particularly in the Edo period, but even up to the present, just as this one, often are felicitous or for good luck, because you're eating something. If you're eating off the ceramic in Japan, then you're eating the health. It's, you know, so this is omedetai, a Thai fish, and you know, so it's a congratulatory, or you know, congratulations, you know, to play with the word of the fish, but also eating from it, you get the luck from the food, and that's still.
I came to Europe. First, I went to Denmark to study ceramic design in the design school. Design school. And also from that time, I getting more influence from the architecture furniture in Europe. So this famous beds, this like Art Nouveau style. And, I really love these floating lines, naturally one shape going to another shape. And then this is the museum, Natural History Museum, I'm looking up, and then these amazing monkey leaves. And then what I like about it is all shapes in motion, it's not stopping. That the leaves is not just, they just draw stopped ones. Somehow, either sometimes it's in wind, not just floating or piling up, or I really like that element in European architecture.
And you have those animals too.
So each subject, each element kind of combine naturally, like a monkey to live sometimes. Then also, of course, England is the very good. So I fell in love with this. The leaf, the detail, the leaf, and the amazing skills as well. And then this detail, what I think great is, it's very thin, but feels really deep.
Yes.
So it have to be applied on the pot, so it can make really build up. It's not elegant, so it make really thin, but still when looking at the figure, feels really depth. If there is a person, still we can feel the volume of the body and
that through the spring mold technique.
So that design I thought is amazing. And this is the Finsbury Park where I live, and I often go in the weekend to exploring and finding out some leaves. And when I find some interesting plants, I don't really take photos and take the leaves and really analyze. Like how the stems look shaped actually, or because just looking at it, it doesn't teach me anything. So that really carefully look at the pattern actually like this. If I look close, actually this pattern looks amazing. So can I just expand?
So you take the leaves with you and
take leaves or just leave in at the place site already. Finish the research, then just store in my head, then go back. Sometimes I do drawings, and then this one is always trying to find back somewhere I didn't notice before. So the pattern of the between these lines, what is going on. Or from the side before flower opens, how it look like. And then this is Nazuna and English daisy ball that Dan said very massive. And this is a mixed memories in one piece, different place. So one is from England, and this Nazuna is the plant from my hometown, Japan. So the
and it's inside and out.
Inside also the covering or dancing spirits. So this one, sometimes the more I get the skills, more I could, I get the ability to express the beauty in nature, which is really satisfying. So I, looking at the tree and very nice, and I made it possible. And then my assistant said, but let's try. So I made this the curved but also pierced sprig. And it's extremely fragile. As I curve, it's already breaking in the beginning. Somehow I managed to make hold of this amount of sprigs.
Is this a recent work?
This is a recent work. And then I loved that the light can... Komorebi, this is the title, Komorebi. The title of this piece, Komorebi. Komorebi means like a light filter through the foliage or branches. So that's why I wanted the light to go through the piece.
Spectacular. Is this a new, is this kind of a new, because a lot of your pieces are very dense, and this is still dense, but it's light, it's open.
It's open.
Is this a, do you think this is a new avenue?
Yes, it needs a new direction. So these also from the inside.
How long did this take you to do?
I
think you all want to know.
when someone asks, so how long did it take? And sometimes people are forgetting. forget and can't remember how long it takes. We're so much into it, and drying time is so long. But I must say, like a few weeks to carve and attaching, probably 3 weeks. I'm doing it, the one piece, and I had to make saga.
Yeah.
So that's also the drying time, probably 3 or 4 months. So half a year, maybe I waited to get the result.
I don't think there's a slide of it, but, and you know, so that means that Jason is going to have to ask Tomi back for another talk once he makes some more work. But if you see in her studio how she dries things, you think, oh, you dry something, you just put it there and it dries. It doesn't do it that way.
No.
It's the most proactive drying I've ever seen in my life. She has, it's like they're little babies in little plastic, in cardboard boxes with plastic and tons of glasses of water, and they're constantly being monitored.
Don't dry.
You know, and just to
now
see.
Now is not the time to dry, okay. So the result is now someone came in, oh, it's a skyline of boxes.
It is amazing to see the drying of the multiple babies, and so the drying is not an, it's not a passive thing, it's a very active part of her work.
Mm-hmm.
The British Museum piece, she told me, took 7 months.
Mm-hmm. I think we we have to wait at least half a year.
Yeah.
So this one, also this massive piece, I probably waited 6 or 7 months, even 8 months.
And not just waiting, it's looking.
Looking and gradually taking out the pool.
And you can't go on vacation.
I can go vacation, but I would be worried. And I can't really get relaxed, so I don't take long holiday. I think maximum is maybe 2 weeks or 1 week, 1 week and a half. And this is the beautiful the wisteria and the honeymoon the English church here. And I'm looking at it, actually, I have that also in my hometown. So this is, I like the honey, so I know it.
And
this is public. I had a solo show at the Colfax and Poa 3 or 4 years ago. And then I inspired by this, the public they have. It's the same as the architecture that this ornament they have. It's like we feel the air, like a breeze in the public. The flower is in motion, so I like that one, so I try to make such a rose with porcelain. And this is a process, so this start is this, so I didn't have, I have a little bit of sketches, but in the beginning just clay, and then gradually it takes time. This model making is very important because then I have to use that shape. for thousands of beings. So have to be really perfect and good and also no undercut. So I take time, some of the big ones, I took 1 month to complete every day I have working on.
Tommy told me the secret to her molds are dental tools.
So the dental tools is very important. So I use to make a mold, model, but also to cut the actual porcelain piece. So this one is the dental tool. I add the handle to ease the pressure on the hands.
So that's the dental tool.
So this one is a video, actually, how I carve the each detail before I apply sprigs.
Oh, so good. Okay, yeah.
Maybe we can cut short. Sorry, the sound.
That's the dental tool that you've built up.
These downstairs also have this sprig, and each line that is going to use this dental tool. Actually, I need to modify it. It takes me a long time, so I...
But you said you get them from dentists when they don't... They're little dolls that the dentists give them to you?
No, I am...
Do you buy them?
No, I buy it, but yeah. Sometimes I can get it. I inspired by the asked to show them so. So, but because it takes so long, but it's fighting with time sometimes. The piece is so big, but I need to finish the carving all thousands of sprigs.
Yeah. So you time. Carve each one.
Yes.
So even though it's made in a mold, you carve.
Yeah,
each
carve.
One.
So the this is not to carve, and this is. The top is coming out slowly and
so you're going from here and you're going down.
So I can do 1,000 ones in 1 week or 2 weeks before the body is drying out. So that I need a help. So the next thing I this one is up there. So that I have a lovely assistant that works in the studio. So it's quite technical, so they need to train a little while. So he is carving again after we apply squash a little bit, so we have 2 days again. So he's slowing and then this one is Nicole told me boxes.
These are, I mean, literally everywhere you look, there are boxes.
This tiny, this bucket, small piece, can plastic shop material. So thank you so much. And I really want to say thank you, Dio Foundation, to prepare this, and also the Nicole, Dr. Nicole from British Museum, and Adrian and all the team. Thank you so much for preparing everything, and also my studio team, and thank you everyone for listening today.